Hello everyone, and welcome to the first tutorial of this series. In this lesson, you will learn some fundamentals of scripting and how to get started. Before we begin, let's discuss what scripting is and why it's needed for Roblox game development. Scripting is like giving instructions to the game to do something, such as creating an object, changing its color, moving it, destroying it, etc. Without these instructions, the game wouldn't function properly because it wouldn't know what we want it to do. To provide these instructions, we use a special language developed by Roblox called Luau, which is a programming language that we will be learning throughout this series. Scripting is an essential skill for creating quality games on Roblox. Now, to get started with scripting, you'll need to have Roblox Studio installed. If you don't already have it, head over to the Create tab on the Roblox website and click on Create Experience to install it. The link will also be provided in the video description. Now, after you've installed Roblox Studio, simply open up the app and log in if necessary. You'll see a window like this. This is where you can create a new place to work on or choose an existing place if you have one. If your studio is in light mode and you want to switch it to dark mode or vice versa, you can do so in your studio settings under File, Studio Settings, or you can press Alt S on your keyboard for a shortcut, and the option is located under the Studio tab in the General section. You can see the property for theme. You can switch to your preferred mode or you can leave it as is. Then you can close the settings window. Now in the new tab, you will find a list of templates provided by Roblox, which you can use as a head start when creating your games. For this series, we will just use the default base plate. When you open up the base plate, you will see a window like this. This is where you build your game. If you're new to Roblox Studio, like I was when I started scripting, then there's definitely a lot to take in. We'll just go through a few things in this lesson, and you can gradually familiarize yourself with the rest of the interface. Now let's try to understand what we're looking at here. We can see a large floor and a strange object sitting on top. This large floor is called the base plate, and it's also the name of our game right now. The object sitting on top is called a spawn location, which, as the name suggests, determines the position where players will spawn when they join this game. We are looking at these two objects through a camera, and all of these things are located in the workspace service, which you can see in the Explorer widget. We have a camera, which is what you are controlling. We have a spawn location, which is this object here, and a base plate, which is the floor of our game. If you don't see the Explorer or Properties widgets open, head to the View tab at the top and click on Explorer and Properties to make sure that they are toggled on, because you will need these two as you develop your games. You can also drag them around to fit them wherever you like, but I prefer to keep them on the side over here. The Explorer shows you all the services and objects in your game, and it allows you to directly insert objects with the plus icon, which appears when you hover over something in it. If you click on the camera object in the workspace, you'll notice that a bunch of stuff appears in the Properties widget below. The Properties widget shows you all of the properties of an object that you can read and manipulate, but if a property is grayed out, you can't change it. As you move your camera around with the right mouse button and your movement keys, you can see some properties change, such as the position and orientation properties. In the coming lessons, we will delve deeper into what these numbers mean and how we can add and change objects through scripting. As a scripter, you'll also need another widget enabled called the Output. To enable it, head back to the View tab and click on Output to make sure it's toggled. The output is essential for scripters because it allows them to communicate with their scripts. If there's a problem with your code, then in most cases, the output will tell you the reason, source, time, and everything else you need to know about it. But for more complex problems, there are also tools available that you can use with your output to identify them, which we will go over later. In short, the output is a scripter's best friend. Now that everything is set up, we can begin scripting. First, we need to create a script object, which is where you'll write all of our code. To do that, hover over Service Script Service in the Explorer and click on the plus icon. Then select Script. If you don't see it, you can type in Script and make sure that you're selecting the default script, not the other ones. This will create a new script and add it to the Service Script Service of your game. A new script editor tab will appear in the tab bar, which allows you to quickly switch back and forth between your main game window and your script, instead of having to click it in the Explorer each time to open it. Script objects can also go in the workspace. but it's better to keep them in your server script service to keep it all organized and make sure that your workflow is less cluttered. Now, if you look at the script that you've just created, you should see a line of code already written in there. It says print hello world. If you don't see it, you might have chosen the wrong script. You can delete that and make sure to add the default script object instead. Now, this line of code is just a default line that every script comes with. All it does is it shows the sentence written in these quotation marks or speech marks, hello world, inside your output widget when you start the game. It's just for the output, so it wouldn't show up anywhere else inside your game. So let's try running this script. To start the game, click the play button at the top. The game will begin to read and run the code in your script. Now, once the game loads, you should see hello world written in the output like this. We'll go over what the rest of this means in a moment. If you want to zoom into your output or script, hover over it with your cursor and hold the control button on your keyboard while scrolling in or out. Unfortunately, this isn't a feature for the Explorer and Properties widgets yet. To stop the game and look back at your script, click the stop button at the top. Now let's try to understand the code a little more. The first word we see is print, which is the name of a function. Functions are like machines. They have built-in functionality designed for a specific purpose. You can sometimes feed them input, and they can sometimes provide some output. Functions work in a similar fashion. The print function takes in some input, such as the sentence that we have here, and it writes it in the output widget. It receives the input through these parentheses, or these brackets next to it. You can change the input to whatever you want. For example, we could change this to hello world, my name is Hiatus. Make sure that whenever you are editing your game, it should not be running, otherwise the changes will not save sometimes. If you run the game again by clicking play at the top, the output widget should now show your new input. Hello world, my name is Hiatus. But let's try to understand what you see here in the output. You could ignore the purple line if there is one. And if you want to look back at your script whilst the game is still running, you can click on the text in the output, and it should open up your script. So the first thing you see is a bunch of numbers. This represents a timestamp. It tells you the time that the print function ran after you started the game. The second thing is the input, which is what you sent to the print function. The third thing says server, which tells you the context, but you can ignore that for now because it's a bit too technical for the first lesson. And the fourth thing says script colon one. This tells you the source, where the print function ran. So the first part, script, tells you the name of the script object which contains your print statement. And if you look back at our script, the name is script. The script object is called script, and that's why it says script here. And the number next to it, after the colon, is 1. This tells you the line number, the line where the print function is in your script. And as you can see, it's on line 1. You can change the name of your script and the line number where your print statement is, and your output should update what it shows for the source when you run the game again. Don't forget to stop the game before you make your changes. So far, you've only been passing sentences to the print function. In programming, we call these words and sentences strings. Any text wrapped in speech marks or quotation marks is called a string, like a string of letters. But there are other types of input that you can use as well. For example, numbers. You can add a new line to your script by pressing enter on your keyboard at the end of this first line, and then you can add a new print statement here. Let's try print open parentheses 10, and don't forget to close the parentheses if it didn't close it for you. Now, if you run the game again, the output should show both the string and the number. Hello world, my name is Hiatus, and 10. You can also send multiple inputs to the print function at once. All you have to do is separate the different inputs with commas. So let's try this. Print I have as one string, 3 as a number, and apples as a separate string. So in this print statement, you're sending 3 different values to the print function. The first is the string I have. The second is the number 3, and the third is the string apples. You can, in fact, write this as one whole string, like this. Print, I have 3 apples. But this is just an example. So now when you run the game, the output should show all of these 3 inputs together. like so. Now before we stop here, if you would like to save your game, you can do so by clicking File and Save to Roblox, and it should pop up a window where you can choose a name for your game, add a description, etc. before saving it. That's all for this lesson. If you would like to practice what you've learned so far, you can try printing different values and see what happens in the output. And if you found any parts confusing, make sure to take a break and freshen up and then try to replay the parts you didn't understand. If you have any suggestions or questions, feel free to add them in the comment section and I'll try to respond to all of them. You can also join our Discord server where we have experienced scripters who can help you out. The link to our Discord server is in the description below. Thanks for watching and I'll see you in the next one.